Skullheads on the walls with the word Lithio inside. The gates of lithium congresses that are guarded by the army. Satellite reports that show that water tables are depleting around lithium mines. Are these signs that the boomer memes that my uncle shares on Facebook were all true from the beginning? Not really, but if the world really needs to produce 3.5 million tons of lithium carbonate equivalent by 2030 and do it the way we've always done it, that will require about 330 million cubic meters of water. Now, to use the popular swimming pool analogy, that's the equivalent of an Olympic swimming pool that would have the width and the depth of a typical Olympic swimming pool, but would not be 50 meters long, but 6,600 kilometers long, so basically spanning in a straight line from New York to Rome. That would make for a long Olympic race, I guess. Now, to make things worse, lithium today is produced in Australian deserts, in Chinese deserts, and in South American deserts. Can you spot the common trait between all those places? Yes, of course, they all have the letter A inside. Coincidence?
I think not.
Maybe it's a conspiracy like in the X-Files! Roswell style!
But seriously, what if I told you that these water consumptions widely underestimate the actual water usage? And not even that, but the most popular way to actually mitigate and reduce that water impact, direct lithium extraction or DLE, would actually probably make things worse and require even more water. So, are we doomed? Well, I went to the soon-to-be world's first ever large-scale direct lithium extraction plant that is built around a technology that requires a lot of water to run to figure out if there is a way out of this catch-22. Spoiler, thankfully there is one, as we'll see in a minute. But I also interviewed dozens of process experts and reviewed about 40 scientific papers only to establish that we seem to have a water-dead angle on that lithium question.
But who the hell are you, man?
Now, if we never met, my name is Antoine, I'm a water engineer. I've been to most of the places that produce lithium today or will be producing lithium tomorrow, and I have a strong belief that water tech is a Lego box that has all the bricks to solve any wicked water problem in the world. You just have to know how to assemble them, and that's what I share here. If that's of interest, make sure to subscribe, and while you do that, ask yourself, where does lithium come from today?
Good question.
I know I just answered that question geographically, typically Australia, China, Chile, Argentina, but from a mining perspective today, lithium is whether extracted from rocks, mostly spodumene, or from brines using evaporation ponds. Now, if you had to guess, between a process which basically requires to break down a big rock into smaller parts, and another process which involves filling large lagoons with highly salty water and let it sit there evaporating for months, which one consumes the most water?
Give me a drum roll. Come on, drum roll. Come on. Louder.
Of course, the hard rock one.
What? What the f***?
Counterintuitive. Right? Producing lithium from hard rocks requires about 160 liters of water per kilogram of lithium carbonate equivalent, against only 30 to 50 kilograms of water per kilogram of lithium carbonate obtained from evaporation ponds. But if these two paths are the only ones that exist at scale today, two more are about to come out of Earth in the coming months: lithium produced from clay, as will be done at Thacker Pass, Nevada, and direct lithium extraction, which will be pioneered in El Dorado, Arkansas, Landau, Germany, and in the place I'm just flying back from, in the Centenario Salar in Argentina, that last one being the closest one to startup, with a commissioning that should start in January 2025, or said differently, next month as I record this. For lithium from clay, it's relatively straightforward. It takes about 120 liters of water per kilogram of lithium carbonate equivalent. But for DLE, it's a different story. Direct lithium extraction is actually not one specific process, but rather the concept of getting straight from a raw brine to a battery-grade lithium product, and that can take many shapes, ranging from solvent extraction to adsorption through ion exchange or various shades of membrane separation. Each of these paths will have a specific water consumption. Solvent extraction or ion exchange require less than 1 liter of water per kilogram of lithium carbonate equivalent, but adsorption can go as high as 1,000 to 1.
How much did you say?
What's specifically interesting is that the process chosen for the world's first large-scale DLE plant sits firmly on the thirstiest end of that spectrum, but we'll come back to that later. So as you see, while evaporation ponds, clay, or hard rock routes have strongly identified water impact, DLE is somewhat all over the places. And it gets even more tricky when you factor in technology readiness level, or said differently, the level of maturity of a given technology, because the ones we know the the best, like the ones that are partially rolled out at scale for almost 30 years, they sit on the right end of that array, among the most water-intensive ones. And as promising as the ones on the left look like, as long as nobody builds them at scale, they are by definition more prospective. But even for the ones we should know better, well, the water question remains fuzzy. When I reviewed the literature seeking the specific water consumption of DLE technologies, I found out that a good chunk of the processes simply skip to give any figures. About a third explain how they are much better than evaporative approaches, another third end up being in more or less similar waters, and the last third simply consumes over 10 times more than evaporation ponds. Sometimes, though, the most obvious numbers can be misleading.
You keep teasing me like that, you're gonna drive me crazy.
Now again, comparing all of those is a bit like comparing potatoes and monkeys. Some are almost rolled out at scale, some others are a cool idea on a lab desk. So let's be specific and let's look at the process picked by Eramet in Argentina for what will be that first ever end-to-end DLE plant I teased you.
Thank you!
To produce their battery-grade lithium carbonate, they rely on an alumina-based adsorbent that holds on the lithium when it passes over it and releases it when you backwash it with fresh water. And that is why this process is water-intensive. You need quite a lot of fresh water to backwash your adsorbent, and as it very mildly concentrates the lithium, you still have a lot of subsequent evaporation to do. And again, what does it evaporate? Water. So picture this, you are at an altitude of roughly 4,000 meters in the middle of a desert with very scarce access to water. And what technology do you pick to extract your lithium? The most water-demanding one. Is Eramet crazy? Well, actually, it's quite the opposite. That's a clever move. To understand this one, we first need to deconstruct an assumption. I told you that when you produce lithium from an evaporation pond, you consume 30 to 50 liters of water per kilogram of lithium carbonate equivalent. And actually, 90% of that water consumption is linked to the use of soda ash. But how can a water evaporation process consume so little water? It doesn't make sense, right? Well, there's a trick. Brine is technically not water.
You filthy liar!
It's water that's so salty that it can't be used for agriculture or human consumption, and so it doesn't qualify as water, which in itself is an interesting play on definitions. Because let's imagine you have a freshwater aquifer and somewhere beneath a brine aquifer. If you pump out brines, well, to quote Aristotle, nature abhors a vacuum, the freshwater aquifer will eventually go down and take the space that's been emptied of brine. So even though you haven't technically used that fresh water, you still made it much more difficult to grab for local communities and other users. Satellite studies of the Atacama Lithium Evaporation Ponds operations show that the water table went down by 9 meters around the pumping boreholes. And even though I'm nobody to assess if that's problematic or not, it somewhat nuances the position of evaporation ponds as the lower consumer of water among all possible lithium mining processes. Depending on the initial lithium concentration in those brines, the amount of water to evaporate will evolve, but to give you an order of magnitude, we're discussing about 500 liters per kilogram of lithium carbonate equivalent. So if we add these 500 liters to our previous figure of 30 to 50 liters, you see that the picture somewhat changes and now resembles this chart, with evaporation ponds moving to the right of the water consumption figures. So that was the first assumption to deconstruct, but there's more in this nothing burger. Because if we look at the processes on the left end of our chart, they are technically fascinating. I'm linking you some of my interviews with great companies developing those processes, and what follows is by no means a critique to those guys, like absolutely not. But to be able to leverage the almost zero water consumption of solvent extraction or ion exchange presupposes that you're allowed to pump out the brine, strip it from the lithium and pump it back somewhere that doesn't deplete your lithium resource, and this can raise environmental concerns. Because no chemical process ever is 100% perfect, I mean, that's nature. So as elegant as solvent extraction is, it's tricky to guarantee that no solvent will ever make it back to the environment when you return your brines. Same with ion exchange, yes, it uses very little water, but it will often require amending the effluent's pH, and beyond the logistical challenge it can be to bring those pH amending agents, you can't return a pH 10 or 11 brine to the environment. I'm not trying to discard all these processes at all. I'm just saying that the picture is certainly always site-specific and quite more complex than what you would be tempted to believe just watching a pitch deck. So with all these caveats, our water consumption chart now looks like this, with a lot of asterisks and stuff to check if we want to leverage the left end of the chart, and still a water riddle to solve if we rather tend for the right side. Now, if you recall my video on Veolia's deep dive, we got an early hint at the solution when Mauro Cruz, their CEO for Latin America, referenced a groundbreaking project in Argentina.
All the water that evaporates, the wind takes to another place, and that area that is already very dry becomes even more drier. How can we solve that? It's technology. It's DLE, Direct Lithium Extraction, using Veolia's membranes technology, reverse osmosis and nanofiltration, coupled with Veolia evaporation and crystallization.
That mention wasn't just a casual name drop. The world's largest water company's involvement in Centenario is actually one piece of a much larger puzzle. But to understand that puzzle, I needed to see it firsthand, which proved to be a journey in itself. Indeed, getting into a lithium production facility isn't like visiting your local water treatment plant. To even set foot on site, I had to prove I was physically fit to work at 4,000 meters altitude. I undertook ECG, stress test, spirometry, blood test, urine test, chest x-ray, and a general medical examination, and that was just step one. Because then came the bureaucratic marathon. I needed a work permit, and getting a work permit in Argentina required a background check, two separate migration office interviews, one in Buenos Aires, and when their IT system crashed, another urgent flight to Salta. I had to provide my work contract, last payslip, proof of salary payments, and various insurance documents, a process that makes finding an apartment in Zurich straightforward in comparison. That was my previous benchmark. And even then, I still had to pass a 4-hour safety training with a test in Spanish.
I have a bad feeling about that one.
For the record, a language I don't speak. But having cleared all these hurdles, I could finally rent a pickup and hit the road with my colleague Ezekiel. We drove 5 hours through landscapes that looked like a crossover between the moon and Mars, spent a night in Santa Rosa de los Pastos Grandes, where the altitude had me convinced I wouldn't wake up in the morning, and then pushed through another hour and a half of otherworldly landscapes to finally reach Eramet. And I also did badass stuff, which I wanted to show you. Why am I telling you all this?
Not to brag, but...
Because this extreme vetting and difficult access underscores something crucial. These facilities are implementing cutting-edge solutions to one of the world's most pressing challenges, and they're doing it in some of Earth's most hostile environments. Remember that Lego brick analogy I shared earlier? Well, that's exactly what I found in this breathtaking landscape. Beyond Veolia, you've got Fluence, Schneider Electric, Eurodia, and even my employer, when I'm not annoying you with my French accent on YouTube, GF Piping Systems, all these water players contributing their specific expertise to solve this water scarcity riddle. But let me tell you, what I witnessed there was worth every administrative headache and altitude sickness headache as well. So remember, brine is not water, but if you desalinate it, I guess it becomes water. Right? And that's how Eramet solves multiple challenges at once. They take the raw brine through nanofiltration, recover some raw water from that, which will go to further treatments, while the concentrate goes to a reverse osmosis step, which further concentrates the valuable parts of the brines, while continuing to produce perfect process water. So you get higher lithium concentrations prior to flowing over the DLE step, you get your process water needs covered with the produced water, you can also cater for the mining camp, and you don't have any brines to re-inject, as you basically use almost all its valuable components. To start with, the plant will run with a 60% water recovery rate, which they will ramp up to 80%.
Technically, I'm an astronaut.
I made the moon/Mars analogy. Well, it's not so distant from the values you'd find on the International Space Station. And the place where they catch this additional recovery potential also gives a broader hint at what's possible overall, regardless of the DLE you pick. The concentrated and purified lithium solution needs to be evaporated and crystallized, but you can recover that evaporated water as, unlike an evaporation pond, in an evaporator, you're basically ruling over the process. And overall, that's why I titled this video, Why Most People Get Lithium's Water Impact Dead Wrong. What this shows is that you shouldn't obsess over the specific water consumption of the DLE step alone. This is just one brick in the wall, just one parameter which, yes, you can optimize, but if you choose to not water optimize that one, you can instead use different Lego bricks and build something else on the steps before or after the DLE. For instance, at Thacker Pass, Nevada, that's also a desert and also somewhat resembles the moon, Lithium Americas, the project developer, went through a similar exercise and teamed up with companies like Aquatech International to roll out a zero liquid discharge plant and even recovering water from the tailings. Closer to Eramet, the two twin giants of Atacama, SQM and Albemarle, are testing out daily combinations to increase their lithium yield at constant water use, while SQM also goes the extra step to roll out systems like Salinity Solutions Batch RO to even out their water balance. So the lesson here is that if you look back at my water consumption chart, optimizing the water consumption of evaporation ponds is tricky. By definition, it evaporates under the sun in an open loop. So you can intensify the process, as SQM and Albemarle plan to do in Chile, but you can't recover that evaporated water unless you place the entire ponds under a dome, which would be stupid, I guess. For lithium obtained from rocks or clay, it's already somewhat different. Yes, it consumes water, but you can add recovery steps before, after, or in the middle, and loop that water to reduce your impact. If we look at the water balance of today's spodumene routes, the biggest consumption are not in Western Australia, around the mines themselves, but in China, around the processing plants. It's water to prepare sulfuric acid solutions, or sodium hydroxide, or carbonate solutions, but also clean water for the purification stages, and all of those can be cycled. Same with all flavors of DLE. Say you're concerned with some solvents leaking out of your solvent extraction process. Well, run your effluent through a air stripping, an activated carbon bed, or an advanced oxidation process, and it should always be safe to go. Or say you fear that your pH amended ion exchanger eluates might have a negative impact on the environment. Well, you can always amend that pH the other way around and bring it back in the 7-ish range. And as we've seen with Eramet, even if your DLE step in itself is water intensive, if you're producing your own water, you somewhat even that out. So am I saying that all is perfect? Not yet, because the lithium price currently is what it is, and if you're required to cut on all extra costs, it can be trickier to explain to your shareholders why the water balance of your process matters to you. Still, if they are concerned about the sustainability of your operations, and by sustainability here I mean your capacity to operate almost no matter what over the next 10 or 15 years, they should understand why removing water access from the critical path makes sense, even if it means slightly raising the costs. And I say raising the costs, but while you're looping all these things, you can also be more circular, extract a broader range of additional minerals, use your chemicals more than once, and even think of next generation steps like carbon capture. This is why I'm convinced that the boomer memes we started with got it all wrong. The water challenge in lithium extraction is not about choosing between lithium and water. It's about choosing the right combination of technologies. And that's not a futuristic or abstract concept. All the bricks you will eventually need are proven technologies that water engineers have been using for decades. Every lithium source presents its own unique challenges, but there's always a specific combination of the Lego bricks I keep coming back to that can solve the puzzle. Every time I visit one of these facilities, I see the same pattern. When we stop looking at water as a constraint and start seeing it as an opportunity to innovate, we unlock solutions that seemed impossible at first glance. Of course, there are still challenges ahead. The Salton Sea, with its $26 billion resource, represents perhaps the most fascinating puzzle yet to solve. If you want to learn more about that, check out my deep dive right here. But that's exactly what makes this field so exciting. Every new project brings its unique water challenges, and I love nothing more than brainstorming solutions for these puzzles. So if you're working out on a lithium project and want to explore your water options, reach out. After all, the right combination of Lego bricks is out there, so if you need help finding them, my email is in the description. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.